Look at this picture. So gentle. I wonder if this child grew up to be a responsible, loving man. Psych! It's actually Adolf Hitler. And our lesson today is about the psycho-historical study of Adolf Hitler. From regarded Hitler as the world's most conspicuous example of a person with the syndrome of decay, possessing a combination of necrophilia, malignant narcissism, and incestuous symbiosis. Hitler displayed all three pathological disorders. He was attracted to death and destruction. Narrowly focused on self-interests and driven by the incestuous devotion to the Germanic race, being fanatically dedicated to preventing its blood from being polluted by Jews and other non-Aryans. Child Hitler was somewhat spoiled by his mother, but her indulgence did not cause his later pathology. It did, however, foster narcissistic feelings of self-importance. His mother never became to him a person to whom he was lovingly or tenderly attached. She was a symbol of protecting and admiring goddesses, but also the goddess of death and chaos. Hitler was an above average student in elementary school, but a failure in high school. During his adolescence, he experienced some conflict with his father, who wanted him to be more responsible and liable civil service job. Hitler, on the other hand, somewhat unrealistically desired to be an artist. Also during this time, he became increasingly to lose himself in fantasy. His narcissism ignited a burning passion for greatness as an artist or architect, but reality brought him failure after failure in this area. Each failure caused a graver wound to his narcissism and a deeper humiliation than the previous one. As his failures grew in number, he became more involved in his fantasy world, more resentful of others, and more motivated for revenge and more necrophilic. Hitler's terrible realization of his failure as an artist was blunted by the outbreak of World War I. His fans and visions could now be channeled into being a great war hero fighting for his homeland. Although he was no great hero, he was a responsible, disciplined, and dutiful soldier. After the war, however, he experienced more failure. Not only had his beloved nation lost, but the revolutionaries within Germany had attacked. He became to power. He demanded that his enemies not merely surrender, that they be annihilated as well. His necrophilia was expressed in his mania for destroying buildings and cities, his orders to kill defective people, his boredom, and his slaughters of millions of Jews. Another trait Hitler manifested was malignant narcissism. He was interested only in himself, his plans, and ideology. His convictions that he could build a terrorist in anyone unless that person was of service to him. His relations to women lacked love and tenderness. He seemed to have used them solely for perverted personal pleasure, especially for voyeuristic satisfaction. According to Fromm's analysis, Hitler also possessed an incestuous symbiosis, manifested by the passionate devotion not only to his real mother but to the Germanic race. Consistent with this trait, he also was sadomasochistic, withdrawn and lacking in feelings of genuine love or compassion. All these characteristics, Fromm contended, that he make Hitler psychotic. Estrangement from culture and well-being. Recall that the central theme to enrich Fromm's theory of personality involves estrangement and alienation. He said that humans have become removed from the natural environment they were designed to inhabit and distance from one another. Furthermore, according to Fromm, the material wealth created by capitalism was created so much freedom that quite frankly, we don't know what to do with ourselves. So anxiety and isolation immediately results too much freedom. Mark Bernard and his colleagues on 2006 sought to test these central components of Fromm's theory through the use of self-reports measures, a sample of undergraduate students in Great Britain. The findings of the study was predicted. The more a person reported that his or her values were discrepant from the society in general, the more likely he or she was to have a strong feeling of estrangement. Sinasabi dito na kapag naiiba ang iyong paniniwala sa mga tao sa lipunan, the more likely you feel alone, which result from anxiety and depression. Taken together, these findings clearly support the ideas of Erich Fromm. The modern society in which we live provides us the innumerable conveniences and benefits, but those conveniences do not come from a cost. Personal freedom and a sense of individuality are important, but when those forces lead people to estrange from their community, it can be harmful to their well-being. One area of research where Fromm's ideas was also continued to be influential is in the development of political beliefs. Fromm's mechanism of escape as a response to a burden of freedom are implicated in political beliefs, particularly in authoritarianism and conformity. Authoritarianism, for example, involves acquiring strength by uniting with a person or a belief system that is more powerful than the individual seeking strength. Being devoutly loyal to one political party is a way to unite with a system more powerful than the individual. Similarly, to conformity involves giving up one's individuality and becoming whatever other person desire one to be. Personality psychologists, one interesting aspect of political beliefs is to examine how people develop the political persuasion they do and whether in personality can predict which type of political party any given individual will drawn to. Fromm articulated how people might be drawn to strongly endorse one political party over another, but his theory does not clearly articulate which party our individual will be drawn to. And Jane Block, on 2006, conducted a longitudinal study in which they assess the personality of a group of preschoolers. Almost 20 years, they followed up with these participants and asked about their political beliefs. When the participants were in preschool, they were evaluated
on a variety of personality dimensions by their preschool teachers who had been trained in personality assessment. This research shows not only how people grew up to deal with their burden of freedom differently, to use Fromm's words, but it also the remarkably powerful predictive ability of personality, even when personality is measured at very age. Fromm was perhaps the most brilliant essayist of all personality theories. He wrote beautiful essays on international politics on 1961, on the relevance of biblical prophets for people today on 1986, on the psychological problems of the aging from 1981, on Marx, Hitler, Freud, and Christ, and on the myriad ideas rate on the 6 criteria of useful theory. He intended to take a global approach to the theory construction, erecting a grand, highly abstract model that was more psychological than scientific. His insights into human nature strike a responsive core, as evidenced by popularity of his book. Scientific perspective, we must ask how Fromm's ideas their topics. First, Fromm imprecise and vague terms have rendered his ideas nearly sterile as a generator of empirical research. The paucity of scientific investigations places him among the least empirically validated of all theorists covered in this book. Second, Fromm's theory is too philosophical to be feasible or verifiable. Nearly any empirical findings generated by Fromm's theory are explained by alternative theories. Third, the breadth of Fromm's theory enables it to organize and explain much of his known about human personality. Fromm's social, political, and historical perspective provides both breadth and depth for understanding the human condition. But his theory's lack of precision makes prediction difficult and falsification impossible. Fourth, as a guide to action, the chief value of Fromm's writing is to stimulate readers to think productively. Unfortunately, however, neither the research nor the therapist reserves much practical information from Fromm's essay. Fifth, Fromm's views are internally consistent in the sense that a single theme runs throughout his writings. However, the theory lacks a structured taxonomy, a set of operationally different terms, and a clear limitation of scope. Therefore, it rates a low on internal consistency. Finally, because Fromm was reluctant to abandon earlier concepts or to relate them precisely to his later ideas, his theory lacks simplicity and unity. For this reason, we rate Fromm's theory low on criticism of parsimony.